Hello, everybody. Welcome to Midweek Unplugged. It is really good to be with you all this evening. As we jump in tonight, I want to invite you to just pause and take a second and become aware that you're in the presence of God. So I invite you just to maybe close your eyes and kind of, center yourself on God and God's presence with you now. Let's begin with this prayer. O wondrous light, flowing from the Holy Creator, O blessed Jesus, who is the light. Now as the sun sets, we see the evening light and sing our praises to the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord Christ, you are worthy at all times to be praised with joyful voices, O Son of God, giver of life, and to be glorified through all the worlds. Our reading tonight is Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 40. So it's the whole chapter of Hebrews 11. So here we go. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain's. Through this, he received approval as righteous, God himself giving approval to his gifts. He died, but through his faith, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken so that he did not experience death, and he was not found because God had taken him. For it was attested before he was taken away that he had pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. For whoever would approach him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. By faith, Noah, warned by God about events as yet unseen, respected the warning and built an ark to save his household. By this, he condemned the world and became an heir to the righteousness that is in accordance with faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance, and he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land that he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received the power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven, and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth, for people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land they had left behind, they would have had the opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when put to the test, offered up Isaac. He who had received the promises was ready to offer up his only son, of whom he had been told, "It is through Isaac that descendants shall be named for you." He considered the fact that God is able even to raise someone from the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked blessings for the future on Jacob and Esau. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, at the end of his life, made mention of the exodus of the Israelites and gave instructions about his burial. By faith, Moses was hidden by his parents for 3 months after his birth, because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called a son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to share ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered abuse suffered for the Christ to be greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking ahead to the reward. By faith he left Egypt, unafraid of the king's anger, for he persevered as though he saw him who is invisible. By faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. By faith the people passed through the Red Sea as if it were dry land, but when the Egyptians attempted to do so, they were drowned. By faith the walls of Jericho fell after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had received the spies in peace. And what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead back. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death, they were sawn in two, they were killed by the sword, they went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, persecuted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains, and in caves and holes in the ground. Yet all these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better, so that they would not, apart from us, be made perfect. Here ends the reading. Our God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Well, when I first came to work at Lord of Life, I came into the office here in Fairfax, and I found something sitting on my desk. I found this sitting on my desk, and I couldn't figure out what was going on. So I went to Heather, our minister for administration, and I said something like, Heather, do you know why there's an owl sitting on my desk? So she explained that everyone on staff at Lord of Life had taken these DISC personality tests, and that included me. And basically, I had taken the test, and I had identified myself as a personality type that was supposed to be represented by an owl. So when I took the test, I had said that I like to use systems to stay organized. I said that I like to make decisions kind of based on logical analysis. And I really, really like to be well prepared for what I do in my personal life and especially my professional life. So I dislike the feeling of being caught off guard. So my personality type is supposed to be represented by an owl. If we could say that Northern Virginia or Washington, D.C. had a personality, so stay with me here, but if we could say that this area had a personality, it might have some of the same personality tendencies as the owl does too. Our culture here loves to have plans. We like to know what's going on, we like to be prepared, we like to know what's going to happen, and we don't like being caught off guard. Many of us spend a lot of our time and our energy thinking about the future, and we plan for the future, and we worry about the future, and sometimes we live in the future. And sometimes we live in the future so much that we miss out on what's happening in this moment right in front of us in the present, because we're so focused on the future. Sometimes we might even miss out on what God is doing in the present because we're so focused on the future and our well-prepared plans. The scripture that we just read from Hebrews 11 shows us how this way of thinking can sometimes get in the way of living faith. So part of Hebrews 10, the chapter before the one we just read, and then going on into this chapter, Hebrews 11, it's kind of this turning point in the book of Hebrews. So Hebrews up to this point is kind of deeply theological. It's focused on a theology, especially of who Jesus is. This chapter, Hebrews 11, kind of turns and changes. It's changes into this more inspirational theme. It's still theological, but it's focused more on how we should live and inspiring us to live in a certain way. And Hebrews 11 holds up a whole bunch of these heroes and stories and legends from the Hebrew Bible or the Old Testament. And it holds up these stories as examples to follow and examples to be inspired by, or stories to be inspired by. And specifically, the chapter talks about these stories as examples of what faith looks like. There's lots in this chapter, but two things particularly stood out to me as I look at it. The first thing that stands out to me that this chapter tells us about faith is that these stories kind of show us that faith is a kind of trust that inspires people to act. So, for example, as an illustration, if I believe or trust that it's going to rain, then I might pack an umbrella. If I believe or trust that the gas gauge in my car is telling me the truth, then whenever the gas gauge is on empty, I'll fill up my car. So in this chapter, in Hebrews 11, faith is a kind of trust that inspires people to act by stepping out and following God. So the chapter has all kinds of actions kind of associated with faith. So by faith, Noah built the ark. By faith, Abraham obeyed and went. By faith, Isaac and Jacob blessed others. By faith, Moses was hidden. By faith, Moses kept the Passover. And on it goes. All these stories about how faith inspires people to act. And as told in these stories, faith in God or trust in God gives the people, these people, the confidence to step out and follow God. So that's the first thing that this chapter tells us about faith. The second thing that I see as I look at this chapter and I think about faith is that faith, it seems to say that faith leads us to this place of uncertainty and risk. So one of the examples that especially stands out to me as I read this chapter is the story of Abraham. So in verse 8 in Hebrews 11, again, it says this: by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. That verse seems to be based on Genesis, way back in Genesis, in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. And it says this: now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. So Hebrews and Genesis tell us this story. And in this story, God comes to this guy named Abraham. And God says, come follow me, and I'm going to show you where you're supposed to go while you're already going. I'm not going to tell you. God says, I'm not going to tell you where to go beforehand. I'm not going to give you the plan ahead of time. I'll tell you while you're going. So faith can lead us to a place of uncertainty and risk. So some of you probably know the psychologist Dr. Brené Brown. And Dr. Brown does research on vulnerability and the strength of vulnerability. So she defines vulnerability as uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure. So vulnerability isn't oversharing. It isn't posting about your deepest feelings on Instagram. Vulnerability is uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure. Dr. Brown connects vulnerability to courage. So she says that vulnerability is the most accurate measure of courage. Vulnerability isn't a sign of weakness, it's a sign of courage. And when you're courageous and you take a risk, you can't control the outcomes. And that feels really vulnerable. So Brené Brown tells this story of when she interviews some U.S. soldiers, and she asks these soldiers, hey, can you give me an example of courage or bravery that didn't involve risk, uncertainty, and emotional exposure? And the soldiers basically respond and say that we can't think of one. Acts of courage, acts of bravery always include uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure. So vulnerability is the biggest sign of courage, is what she says. So an example that comes to mind for me, much less brave than a soldier, but what comes to mind for me is when I told my wife that I liked her and wanted to date her back before we were together. That felt really risky and vulnerable because she could have said no. I felt exposed. I wasn't in control of the outcome. So courage feels vulnerable. It can feel vulnerable and risky and like you're out of control whenever you do things like try to build a new friendship or whenever you have a difficult conversation. It can feel vulnerable and risky and like you're somehow exposed whenever you let go of the way you've always done things, whether that's in your career or church or relationships or something else. Whenever you step into something new, it can feel risky and vulnerable and like you're not in control. So having courage feels vulnerable because you can't control the outcomes. So how does that relate to Hebrews 11? The story that Hebrews 11 tells us about Abraham is that God tells Abraham to leave home. And it says that God will show him where to go along the way. God would show him where to go only after he left home. That's a description of courage and vulnerability and not being in control of the outcomes. Abraham wasn't, as told in the story, Abraham wasn't in control of what was going on. So it might be fair to say that faith also often looks like and feels like uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure. It might be fair to say that when we step forward in faith, we aren't in control of the outcomes. God is. So if courage is stepping forward, when you can't control the outcomes, then faith might be the same. We step forward because God is leading us, even when we aren't in control of the outcomes. I had this really wonderful advisor when I went to seminary, and I was debating about which degree program to take, and I was sitting in her office kind of being anxious about this decision, and she told me that something to the effect of saying that God sometimes just leads us one step at a time. We don't get the plan in advance. God walks with us and doesn't give us the plan in advance. And then she made some recommendations of some classes I could take that semester. And then she very practically reminded me that I could figure out which degree program I wanted to pursue later on, just get through the next semester. But the lesson that she was saying is to step forward in faith. Step forward in faith, have courage, and God will lead you as you go forward. So may we be people of faith who walk forward and follow Jesus with courage and vulnerability. Thanks be to God, who is always walking with us and who leads us into a life of freedom and courage and faith. Amen. Now let's pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I receive this evening blessing. May the light of Christ scatter all your darkness and bring you peace this night as you rest in his grace, forgiveness, and his everlasting peace. Amen.